Hello. How are we doing? Hey, I'm back after a little hiatus. I can't remember why. Oh yeah, I had really shit internet. They had to come and deal with that. So that's cool. Got that sorted. Back up to some decent levels finally. And then I kind of decided I wasn't really into doing studio as so me in the studio, to be honest. I don't know, just it wasn't flowing right. So I thought I'd try something else. And that is, I'm gonna chat to mates basically, chat to people, friends, musicians. And give you a bit of insight into who they are, and hopefully you learn a bit about them. And I thought I'd kick it off with who I actually consider to be one of the best producers that I personally know, electronic music anyway. He's an absolute G. He's annoyingly good. And due the late start is due to the fact he's on the other side of the world. So without further ado, should we get him in here? Yeah. Hello, Joe. Where are
Can
you?
you hear me?
Here he is. Yeah, I
Hello, mate.
can. How you doing? You all right?
I'm good. Morning.
Yeah. Yeah,
Yep.
morning.
Got my coffee.
And yeah, I got my beer.
Good boy.
Nought
Okay.
percent still, I might add. 0%.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
What's
It's
it
just
like?
this one's actually not bad. Jupiler. It's that's
Jupiter.
yeah, it's got a product placement there, and it's sort out. Yeah, it's
Oh.
actually all right. It's not too shabby at all. I like it. So I've got to give it a go. But yeah,
Wow.
so Joe
Yes.
Seven,
That's me.
how you been, bruv? How's life on the other side of the planet?
It's good. It's I suppose much like everywhere else, just last year's been a bit of a shambles.
Yeah.
But to be fair, it's pretty normal here.
Yeah, you guys have been in and out of like lockdowns, right? They keep putting them, placing them on you, and then taking them off, and
They went straight for the hard lockdown early last year.
okay.
And that lasted in Melbourne for where we are for ages, 4 months
Yeah.
or something. And there's still some restrictions now. Well, a lot of restrictions really compared to what it used to be.
Yeah.
But there's hardly any cases and it's all fairly normal. And to be
That's good.
honest, I'm a bit of a hermit anyway, so it didn't really make any difference to me.
In that cave of yours, I can see there. Oh, is that
Yes.
the is that the is that the is that the OB6 there? I thought you had the desktop version. Is that the keys version?
No, that's the keys, mate. Come on.
I thought you. Oh, okay.
No, I've got
That's
the.
yeah.
I thought I'd
Lovely
splash out on the
OB6.
desktop one.
Wicked.
I mean the keyboard one, and then everything else is pretty much apart from the old keyboards over here. Everything else is kind of desktop because I don't have much room.
Yeah. Scene. Wicked. So what I wanted to do is just kind of like just go through some of your music basically, and have get some
Sure.
insight to it, and what I don't know, just yeah, just get a bit more insight, give people a bit more insight, because to be honest, I think you are really, I'm not gonna say underrated, but you're just like, you're not as you should be fucking huge, dude. And I've said this to you before, and it's always bugged me that you're not. So, but and you've had some big tunes, and obviously the ones on Exit, But I was looking at your Discog and trying to work out what your first release was. And yeah. the one I don't think is Ease Forward. Is that right?
No. That was the second one that I did with
Noisier, right?
Noisier, yeah.
Okay.
The first one was Hand Gestures.
Oh. Mm. Doesn't get much bigger than that. Hold on a second.
Well, that's pretty much set the bar. I mean, let's be honest. Nick was engineering a lot of that.
Yeah.
But we did it in my house at the time in Melbourne, and this would have been 2007, maybe.
Oh, really? Is that because it didn't come out till later, right?
I think it came out 2008. I'm not sure. I can't remember. Okay. Yeah. It came out on their album, so whenever that came out. But we'd finished it quite a while before that.
Okay.
We did it at my house, and they came around and... was it just Nick? Was it Nick and Tice as well? I think Tice was there as well.
Okay.
And we just... I didn't have really any outboard gear at the time. I was just doing stuff in the box and just trying to feel my way around it and not, just teaching myself because I was out here and I didn't really know anyone at that time who was writing music. I was just sort of just blagging it and just trying to figure it out, throwing things at Cubase and seeing what happened. So then Nick came over and Nick and Tice came over and, they had their method already down. And they taught me a lot about working with audio specifically, because that's what they always did.
Okay.
They would come with it must have been CDs at the time. Or was it USBs then? I can't remember. Of shitloads of sounds that they'd made, breaks, bass hits, whatever, pads. Like an audio dump, and they all had at least three of them on them all times, it seemed to be, and they were just they had all that. And but we didn't really start with that. We just he just pulled up a lot of my samples and some old breaks and some bits and bobs that we chose together, and just threw it together.
Shall we have a listen?
If you've got it. I don't think I've got it anymore.
Really? Cut D.
No. I need to buy it.
Okay, let's have a look then. Thank you. You know that's naughty. So, funnily enough, Tice hit me up, asked me if I wanted to remix from the back catalogue, and I said this.
Really?
Yeah, so...
Dude, I would love to hear that.
So would I.
Yeah, when you get the parts, send them to me. I'll do another one.
Yeah, you'll probably do a better one as well.
No, I don't know. That would be cool.
But so this, so I always thought this came out as a single, so it was on the album, right?
It was on the album. Maybe a shorter version of it was on the album, and then they did a longer version for an EP, possibly.
Okay.
I don't really remember. Wish it did. Be great to see those guys again.
I've been speaking to Tice a fair bit recently. He's doing all right. So after that, so Ease Forward, would that be next?
Ease Forward was, yeah. So Ease Forward we did in the same
week, same
sort of, so they came around and we did that one. We started that one and got the basics of it down. And then... and then I think a few days later, maybe...
I'm going to just play it in the background while you're talking, by the way. Sorry, go on.
Okay. A few days later, they came around and did the same thing, basically. I sort of picked... essentially, I was just selecting sounds.
Yeah.
And they were engineering, you know, just doing what they do. And we'd sort of decide where things would happen or where they wouldn't happen and get it to a state where, you know, the bulk of the track was down. It was like a sketch. And then they basically took them both away back to Groningen.
Okay.
And finished them. And then just sent me the things. And it turned out really good. Way better than I could have ever imagined.
This one's naughty, actually, because I was looking at it and I thought, I don't recognise this tune. I didn't recognise the name. And it sounds like you've got that Desecrated in there. Is that the old Desi?
The bass sound?
Yeah.
Don't think so. I think that was... it wasn't, because I never had that sample pack. I'm pretty sure... that was just Nick and or Tice doing some weird alchemy with just the stock Cubase synth and lots of multi-band dynamics, I remember.
Yeah,
resampling, multi-band, resampling, more multi-band.
Okay.
From memory, but that's I could be wrong.
Okay, sick.
It's really good. I was pretty excited, given that they were the first two. They were pretty much the first two tracks that I'd been involved with in any way that I'd seen to completion, like from, you know, like messing about. And then to hear a finished product, obviously, you know, they were a huge part of that happening.
Yeah.
But it was really cool. Very inspiring the way that they worked. And I still, you know...
Has some of it rubbed off on you, some of the techniques and stuff? Or?
Absolutely. You know, because up until that point, I thought everything... was just sample, you know, you just find samples and whack them together and it would be a tune. And I'm sure lots of people do that and can do that really well. But they were very much into audio manipulation, so they wouldn't have a sample or a sound they made themselves and then edit the audio, bounce it down to audio in the project and then do some processing and then bounce it again and, you know, just continuously doing that.
Yeah.
To turn it into something a bit better or a bit more unique.
Okay.
And I still you know, in my mind now, I think of making music in audio rather than, you know, so audio, like bounced, recording yeah. audio, if you will, rather than just sounds that you've found.
I'm sort of late to that in the sense I've started doing that more now than I did.
Mm.
Then I was always, since especially with Logic, I was all very much MIDI based. It was all like EXS and just triggering MIDI. And because it just felt like Logic really wasn't really great at dealing with handling audio.
Cubase was way better at the time.
True. And I did try Cubase. I think I did one track on my album. What was that on? Was it on the Too Late EP? Maybe something like that. But I always, in my head, it always thought it sounded better. But then since moving to Bitwig, like, it's just been all audio, pretty much, you know, and manipulating that and having a lot more fun with it as well, actually. So what was after that then? Where would you, had you, because when did we meet? Because I must have met you in New Zealand, right? No,
we met in passing a few times in Melbourne, like at gigs and that. When you came over to play, but at that point I wasn't producing. You know, before that I was just DJing and working in record shops.
Okay, which record shop did you work in Melbourne?
DMC Records.
All right. Okay.
Yeah, so they were the guys that I don't know if they're still around in the UK. They're certainly not here. But they used to do the DMC Championships, you know, the hip hop scratching turntables things. And they had a guy called Stuart from Leeds, actually, moved out to Melbourne in the 90s, mid 90s.
Yeah.
And started a franchise store of the DMC thing, so you know, like over here basically.
Yeah.
So then they did turntable competitions here as well, and like all that, you know, the Back to Mind CDs and all that sort of stuff.
So
he was importing all of that. He was importing all the Technics decks, all the UDG record bags.
There was a DMC, was there a DMC in Auckland as well? I met you in passing, but so when did we properly get introduced, would you say? Would it be through Cam?
Yeah.
Because so what's your connection? How did you and Cam get to know each other then? Because obviously you two became they live and
yeah. We met probably. Well, it's very foggy, mate.
doesn't surprise me.
We met shortly after I finished Hand Gestures Hand Gestures. After that was sort of in the bag, and I thought, okay, maybe I can. And after speaking to those guys, and they were like, because I should mention that Nick was sort of coached me quite a lot in terms of, you know, the potential to be involved,
okay,
you know, in the world of production. And you know, I played him some of my things before, you know, the things I've been messing about with. And he said, look, they need a lot of work, obviously. But, you know, I can sort of see you, you know, within the sort of realms of people like you, comics, Alex Perez, you know, that sort of area. He said, look, just keep at it. And, you know, this sounds good. So he gave me the confidence. And then we did Hand Gestures and Eastford. And that gave me the confidence to go, okay, I can give this a shot.
Yeah.
So after that happened, we... in a club somewhere. How did we meet Cam? Anyway, I met him in a club. I've gone out with This is going to be a very sporadic story, I'm afraid.
That's okay.
Yeah, we met in the some club somewhere, got chatting about music, and you know, sort of got onto the subject of what we were into. Obviously, this was sort of all within drum and bass at this point.
Yeah.
And I was sort of saying that, you know, I was really into what you were doing. I think Marcus, you know, solo, yeah, that sort of stuff. Instrumental, I just maybe put the thing out on solo.
Okay, yeah, Naked Zoo.
And yeah, and Darkestral had just started.
Okay.
So maybe the first release was it at Comanche? Or am I?
I want to say, was it the Translucent? Was it the Sepia? Sepia
Tone? No, that was long after.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I can't remember. Go on. I know Piotr, I know. Piotr, what was the first release on Darkestral?
Anyway, so that sort of...
Yeah, you're right. And you're like,
all right. Yeah. So, yes, we got talking on that, and we were sort of saying that I sort of like that sort of, you know, dark, moody, sort of cinematic kind of vibe. And he was like, yeah, that's totally me. And then he said, I said something about Darkestral. Said, okay. Oh, there's this new label, Darkestral. It's really cool. He said, oh, yeah, I've been signed to it. And I was like, what? At first, I kind of didn't believe it. it was so random, and I just couldn't believe that. I don't know why.
A dude you'd met in a club.
Yeah, just randomly in this new label like, that I really liked. And he was just like, oh, yeah,
I'm excited. That's top bullshitting, basically.
Yeah. Yeah, because you hear that a lot in clubs, don't you?
When you go out,
oh, yeah, I've been signed to fucking, you know, yeah, I've been on Metalheads for years, mate. So, yeah, so he said that, and I was like, wow. You know, I had a radio show at the time.
Okay.
That's what it was. And I said, oh, that's really cool. Do you want to come down to the radio, you know, and play some music and, you know, that sort of thing? And do you want to hook up and we'll, you know, try and write something together?
Okay. And what was that then? What was the first thing that you guys wrote?
Yeah, it was shit.
Had I already signed Cam by this time, as in like for his album?
No,
okay.
I think you'd met Cam previous to this, and go on.
Yeah, no, I'll say I met him in New Zealand prior to that with like Ollie, Cern, and Johnny, rest in peace. So back then, because it's blurry for me as well, the whole time, that era. Yeah. So 2010, because Live Forever came out.
Live Forever came out in 2009, I think.
Okay.
Hang on a minute. This is all.
No, wrong. That can't be right. It was 2000. What year did
you... Let me have a look at Discogs. Hang on.
Don't worry. Piotr's got it. Piotr's got it. He'll deal with it.
Start at Hand Gestures, whatever year Hand Gestures came out.
Yeah,
it's all after that.
Okay,
but if I can get a handle on that, oh fucking hell, I don't know.
Let's have a quick look.
Anyway, the dates don't really matter, do they?
No, not really.
It'd be nice to get a timeline. Right.
Yeah. Okay. 2010. It says Hand Gestures. Ease Forward. 2010, and then Council Standard was 2011. Okay, you had quite a busy year, 2011.
Yeah.
So.
Right. Okay. So then that means.
So cancel standard because this would have been after Live Forever.
Yes.
Yeah. So Live Forever
wasn't
was
long after.
It wouldn't have been long after, but it was like Live Forever was like 2009, 2010, and which is around obviously the autonomic years, which is when.
Yeah.
Cam was coming through, and I actually found, I don't know, did this ever come out? Hold on, where is it? We've got unreleased. Uh, So hold on a second. Let's have a look here. Let's get this in here. Where are you? Did this ever come out?
No.
This was your remix of Lime Green, which was off the first album, right?
Yeah. But that was...
Because I was looking, you know, obviously searching through the hard drive, and I came and I was like, hold on a minute. Well, let this one play for a bit. Yeah, so I can't remember why that didn't come out.
I was just never ever happy with the mix, but the bass was the bass. It was super, super, it was just so low. I don't know what it was. It was some synth, and I just could never get, I had this idea in my head of what I wanted it to be like.
Yeah.
Sort of tribally drums and super, you know, sort of nondescript swirly thing. I just couldn't get it to work, basically, and it just always sounded a bit crap to me, so I wasn't really that keen on it.
Okay, that's fair.
I like the idea. Like, there's some nice bits. Like, I re-recorded the synth lines, you know, like the from the original ones. I replayed them on, because at the time we were sharing a studio, me and Cam.
Okay.
This was the cancelled standard era. And I think he'd, because we were, I should probably, I don't know, am I going too far forward now?
No, go on.
Where were we at?
We're just around cancelled standard, basically.
Yeah, so it wasn't long after I first met Cam that we, he might have even been signed to Exit when we met, actually.
Okay.
Now I think about it, because I think he was, because I remember when I first went round, I think he played me an early version of 11 Circles. I was like, fucking hell, this is great.
Yeah.
So he was probably working on that then. And then that came out. What happened?
No, so, then, so this, like, what happened?
Yeah, I think probably, basically, yeah, They Live basically happened because Cam, because we'd started writing things together.
Yeah.
And he'd done Live For Never. And I think he must have approached you and said, oh, I've got, you know, I'm writing stuff with this guy. Like, I don't know. What happened?
Yeah, what the fuck did happen? Yeah, he must. I'm pretty sure that would have been the case that. Did you move? Because you moved to, obviously, were you still in, when Council Standard was, were you still in Melbourne then, or did you move to England by then?
When it was released.
When you'd written it.
No, we were still here.
Both of you were.
Yeah. So okay, we were both. Right.
So you both didn't come over until, because I'm trying to work out when you came over as well. Because when you came over, we pretty much hooked up straight away, and because obviously you were working for me as well. You were working for Exit. Jesus Christ, why is that? My memories are terrible. I was talking to Damon about this the other day.
It's so bad. It's all there.
If we hadn't released music, if it wasn't this kind of that sort of musical catalogue of what we'd done, I haven't got a clue what's going on.
Let me think. All right, so anyway, yeah, so Cam made They Live happen. Mm-hmm. Happened because of him.
Right,
and then at some point we decide that's it,
go on.
I was in a relationship with someone who she got a job way out of Melbourne, like,
okay,
3 hours on the beach, basically.
The
honeysuckle era. Well, that's where Council Standard was written. We did all that there. Go on.
No, you did, because I remember you were, because you two pretty much were locked away then. And you were using, and when didn't one of you have like a DX7 and then.
Yeah, I've still got it here.
And what was the drum machine you were using? The SR something? Was it the?
Hang on a minute.
There she is.
Yeah.
Modded to fuck.
Yeah. Funky Toofers mod. Look at that. I love the little instrumental harp. Look at that.
Oh, shit.
Yeah. Thanks, Damon. We bought this in a shop in Melbourne. Music Swap Shop is really cool.
Yeah.
The ones in Melbourne. Yeah. That was Cam's idea. Bless him. we use that a lot. So hang on a minute. So we're totally missing out the Autonomic.
Well,
Pure Palms and
Pure. Okay, yeah, Pure Palms.
That was before.
And then, oh, so hold on, I've got another, where is it? Wow, this one. Yeah, you remember that?
Yeah.
That was Mosaic Volume 2, right?
Yeah.
Okay, Will can confirm that. He's got a better memory than all of us, I think.
It's that veggie diet.
Yeah, definitely. So... Yeah, I always like this. You see, this is...
I like this one.
This, for me, is kind of like... Where I was like, hold on. Because you've got this real... You've got this knack and this ability of writing great melodies. And really sort of... how can I describe it? It's almost like nostalgic. Almost like... I feel like I've heard it. But I know I haven't, do you know what I mean? I think I said this to you before, he's got this real familiarity to him, you've got this ability, there's things on like the Near Far album that just are so, like seminal kind of like pieces, and this was kind of like, this was like the early foray into that for me.
Yeah.
Bad tune.
Nice.
Sick bass line. Yeah.
I did that. on. So I wrote this in the box.
Oh yeah?
Yeah. And that bass was from, remember that? The Revolution.
Oh, the quasi MIDI.
Yeah, the quasi MIDI. Oh yeah. Revolution. That was that was for that.
What, my one? No, yeah. I had a Sirius, I had a quasi MIDI, I had a Sirius.
Oh, not the quasi. Oh, was it a quasi MIDI? Sirius quasi MIDI.
It was one of those things.
Maybe it wasn't the Red Witch. Anyway, it was from that one.
Yeah, this is a tune. This was a sick album, actually. Actually, me and Will have been talking about bringing back Mosaic. Time for part three, set. Possibly. Yeah.
Awesome.
There was some good stuff on there, man.
There's so much of that music down from that era. Those years from sort of 2007 to whenever, 2010, 2012. Just amazing. Still, you know, gives me goosebumps when I hear lots of it.
Yeah, definitely. So I want to play something off Cancel Standard. What do you want to hear? You pick something. What's your favorite off there?
What's my favorite?
Yeah. Who's Mr. Spaulding?
That was my dog. That was my little. That was my little staffy. I had a little English staffy called Spaulding. So he moved out to the beach with us, and there was four of us living out there, me, my missus, Cam, and the dog.
Okay.
And this is such a fucking cool house. It was like a sort of modular. It was like a semi-circle thing with all like wood paneling inside, and it was sick. Right by the beach, like heard the ocean when you woke up, you heard it when you went to sleep. It was mad. No internet. Remember, there was no internet.
We had to drive. It was fucking ball ache getting shit out of you lot.
Yeah, we had to drive. I don't know, like 40 kilometers to this little local library in rural Australia. with these two old nanas working there, me and Cam would bowl in like every now and again, fucking in a haze, with USB sticks trying to upload them with our little library cards on some shitty dial-up internet to try and send you ideas and artwork, or check our emails and to see if Will had sent us an email about something really important and we wouldn't get back to him for fucking a week because we hadn't been to the library. It wasn't exactly fast paced. Go on.
Well, I just think that kind of shows in that album as a whole. Do you know what I mean? It's kind of like it's beautifully put together. Do you know what I mean? And I think that's what I really, really like about it. I'm trying to think what my favorite is off there, but I want you to pick something. So you got Cancel Standard, 7998, Nage, is it Nagy's Lover? Nage's Lover, who's that?
I call it Nage's Lover, but...
Nage's Lover, Mr. Spaulding's Night, Let Us Down, Cavalier, The Ridgeway, Horizonta, Cacciatoria, Nuvo 37, The Alive and Today.
I'm trying to think. Obviously can't play the whole thing. But I don't really have a favourite...
Okay.
You know, specific track. I just like listening to the whole thing because, and that was partly how we wanted it to be.
Yeah.
Totally how we wanted it to be digested.
Yeah.
It was this, and like you say, like a little sort of microcosm of a world that, you know, two minds had been in it. You know what I mean? And like, I feel like, it kind of was that because it actually was that, you know, it wasn't manufactured to be that. It was just, that's was why we moved out there. We're like, let's just go out to the beach and fucking hole up and write an album. Play Mr. Sporting's Neighborhood. You mentioned Sporting, but play that one. I can't remember which one that is.
Okay, let's have a look. Where is he, Mr. Sporting? Yeah, this is a tune. It's so messy. Geez. Ugh. Yeah, Will knows. Curse lit. Yeah, all right. You still there? Can you hear me? Oh, your voice has gone. What's going on? That's all good.
You hear me?
Yeah, all good. We're back. Yeah, that's a bad tune.
I always like this little acidy line at the end.
Yeah.
That was a count. Like
let's hold on. I want to see if Bruce shows up. Seems like free Bruce.
Who's Bruce?
If you follow Damon's Twitch, you'll know who Bruce is.
Yeah, you talk about nostalgia, just this whole hearing these tunes and particularly Cancer Standard, just remembering it is just so good, man. Like, we really felt free and, you know, I think that comes from, you know, leaving a city that you've lived in for a while. And I've bounced between cities all over the world, between here and England.
Yeah.
And, just to get out and not live in a city and just have a studio where, you know, basically we were self-sufficient as well, because at that time we were playing enough gigs and I had some regular things that were able to pay the bills in the house.
Yeah.
By just going back to Melbourne. Basically every weekend we drive back, or every second weekend, you know, a lot, and we'd go back and play some gigs and do a bit of work for a friend of mine as well, and then you know, then drive back on the weekend and spend the bulk of the week just in the studio and build. And because we'd by that point, well, Cam had already had quite a lot of hardware.
Yeah,
he was really the one that sort of turned me on to, you know, getting into buying gear. Because he, when I first met him, he had like the 8P, and which he used a lot on Live Forever, and he had a Waldorf Micro Q, which he's still got.
Okay.
which was sick. Use that a lot. And quite a lot of other ones. But you know what? I found some pictures of the studio somewhere. I'll send them to you.
Yeah, please do.
So we just filled it with gear, basically, this room. It's probably not, it's probably a bit bigger than this one now. And then he had his computer, and we were both on, he was on Mac, and I still had a PC at the time. So I had my little PC in the corner of the room, like the fucking little elf in the corner, just, and his Mac was like the center, and we had all the keyboards around. And so I would be just coming up with sketches and ideas on Cubase on the PC. Like I was saying, going back to the, you know, just throwing audio together. And then we would put it into the Mac. He had an Alan Heath desk as well.
Okay, yeah.
Ran everything through. So we'd do that. I just do some sketches. We put it into the Mac, and then we'd just basically just jam keyboards over it and fucking whatever effects and
and then
build them all on his. And I think we recorded a lot of them to DAT as well.
Okay, going old school, yeah.
Yeah, because we've got this. I've still got it. It's over there.
I've still got mine as well. I've still got one, but I haven't used it in a while. I should. Needs repairing. But
yeah, well, you see, like, because now you know, you get all these plugins that are like, you know, bit reducing, and you know, like, you know, every door's got them, and you know, you change the, you know, the sampling rates and all that sort of stuff to get a sort of, you know, vintage digital whatever sound.
Yeah.
But so we just got that and just fucking, you know, like some tracks we would just smash it, which obviously would be like, oh, that's, you can't do that. It's digital clipping. It's going to sound shit. But
well, no, that was, I know that Dillinger used to do that a lot. Like he used to, you'd get DATs when we were cutting his tunes, and it would be like, the noise floor would just be maxed. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So
it's like,
so that was a common, you know, a common trick, technique, so to speak. Yeah.
Yeah. We liked it because, and I like still, I don't do it as often as I should.
Mm.
And maybe I would finish way more tunes if I did, because for me, you've recorded everything, and if you run something into something like a DAT or a cassette machine, or squeeze everything through some box or another, you know, everyone talks about gelling the sound and all that, but it to me, it's just, maybe it does and maybe it doesn't. Obviously it's going to have some effect, but it's just the process of doing that to me just says, okay, that's now its own little creature, you know what I mean? It's its own, because you've cooked it in one pot, as it were, you know.
And
it is what it is now. And if it sounds a bit scratchy in it, or if it sounds a bit digitally, or if it sounds muted, that's just who it is. You know what I mean? I like doing that, because then you can go, okay, it's done. And once you've done that, you can't change it. You know, you can go back through the project these days, but I like doing things like that.
Yeah, same. I used to like doing things like that. I'm just real lazy now, though. But so where are we now? We're moving along now, and then you had a release, Exit 32, Untitled Monotron, and Prologue.
Oh, yeah.
I'm assuming the Monotron references to the Korg Monotron. You must have used that, because we both had them then, didn't we? That's when that kind of like whole sort of synth companies were starting to release things again. You know what I mean? And it was a Korg Monotron. What did they do? They had three, didn't they? The duo one, and then like an echo one, a delay one.
Yeah.
That was also 2011 by the looks of it.
That was a productive period. Probably my most productive.
Yeah.
Well, certainly, definitely.
I can't decide which of the two I prefer. Untitled Monotron. Go on then.
Go on. No, go on. No, I'm not, I'll let you. This is
no,
your,
no, no. It's you because I do like Untitled Monotron because it's just a stepper.
Mm-hmm.
But your favorite?
I like the other one. but play Monotron.
Shall we play Monotron? Let's have a look. Let's play. No. We're playing Prologue. Sorry, mate.
Go on, mate. That's good. So this was again written out in the honeysuckles. And used the Roland JP-8000 a lot.
Oh, right. Do you know what? I still got my eye on one of them. The 8080 is the desktop version kind of it, right? The JP-8080. Yeah. But I kind of like, I'm still hanging for the 8000.
It was sick because it had a ribbon on it, I think.
Yeah, that's right.
And which of all those sort of little swirly things, it's just so easy to do and fun.
Yeah, Damon, you do love a stepper. Hello, Hannah. Here we go. Right. Yeah, that's okay. I've always liked this one. This whole era of Exit with this sleeve. I really enjoyed this era. There was a lot of exciting stuff coming out. Yeah. The synchro stuff, you know, Code Free. It was just so much good stuff. And I always loved this sleeve. Fugtronic. Will's asking for the other side. I suppose we should for Will. I suppose we can't, can we? Here you go, Will.
Yeah, so the Monotron, I'll let it play and I'll tell you what it is.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah, naughty tune. Mm. It is, it's like Will's right. That kind of had that Johnny L kind of that, and what was it like? Obviously, the one that Insta did with Output 1-2. Do you know what I mean? That kind of stepping, quite lo-fi sort of.
Yes. Lo-fi.
Yeah. So go on. What did you do?
Well, yeah, it sounds lo-fi because it was like I, you know, just wrote the beat or whatever. Don't remember what I used for that, but then, like I said about running shit through boxes, the Monotron, I just got it, and I thought, fuck it, I'm gonna just run the whole beat through. I went out of the desk into a little mini jack, into a little plastic box, and just whacked it in. And I just recorded it through it and fucked with the filter, the little tiny pop filter on it.
So hold on, does the mon, because I've got one over here, did it have an audio in and an audio out?
Yeah.
I coughed, did it? Hold on a second. He's right as well. It did.
Yeah. So if you ever want to lo-fi your beats, you know, like
that's a cheap, this bad boy.
Yeah, it's a cheap way to do it, and obviously it's got the little LFO on it, and you can do all kinds of crazy shit. I've made heinous bass sounds just using that.
Okay. So the he has got an aux in. Of course, I forgot he had that.
And it was.
And then there's this one as well, the duo one.
I never had that one.
Okay.
My delay one's battery's bled and it's knackered now. But yeah, I've still got the Monotron.
Okay.
So I just threw it through that, and that's why it sounds so crunchy and weird.
Sick. I might have to give that a go. Thanks. Thanks for the tip.
Yeah, you should.
And, but yeah, that's a bad tune though.
And another little side note: the vocal samples from Flight of the Navigator.
Geez, that's my era. That is
big film.
Sick! That is a huge film.
It's got some good samples in it.
So like where vocals. Are we next? So this is still 2011. You had another in 2011. Exit 27. How is that before? Exit 27, exit 32. Will, what was going on then? Our numbering was all over the shop. The 10 inch.
Mm.
Again, these tunes were sick. I love these ones. Let me find it. Hold on. So when did you start working for me for Exit?
That was after I'd moved back to the UK for good.
Yeah.
Well, you know, that was the plan. Which would have been 2000 and at the end of 2011, I think.
Okay.
To 2012. But then it would have, when you guys decided to go independent, it was that was that.
Yeah.
So I think that was maybe 2012, maybe.
And when did you start working for Black Market?
Before that. Not long. Look at
him. Here he is.
Shortly after I moved to London, that happened.
Yeah.
Well, maybe 6 months or something. Hey, Jesus, look at me. I'm skinny.
God, check us out. Mixing vinyl. Fucking hell.
Yeah. When was that?
Was this a record store day? I feel like it was a record store day.
Oh, then no, there would have been more people there.
Oh, no. Maybe it was almost like, maybe it might even have been a lock-in.
It looks like a lock-in because there's not much light coming through the windows. Maybe. And there's a bottle of something nondescript in the front. So,
yeah, that's probably Will's beer. He was always about.
Mine, mate. Yeah, that happened not well, yeah. I don't think it was that long after I got there. That was that happened through Natalie.
Okay,
DJ
flight.
Flight.
Yeah.
Yeah,
Wicked.
we got chatting and I told her about, working in shops, and it just so happened that at the time they needed someone to work in the basement bit in the drum and bass section, or drum and bass dubstep section. And it just all came
Oh,
together.
okay. I always thought you were upstairs, so you work downstairs as well.
Yeah, I started
Okay.
downstairs. That was
Ah.
before, or
So
that might have been.
you were shifting them exit units back then.
I was. No, what I mean, no, hang on. Yeah, no, I was.
Yeah, good. Like Ray used to do with Penny, was it Dread?
Yeah, Dread and Penny Black.
That's the one.
Yeah, Ray, he was great. Yeah, that was a good time. It was fucking, it was a pleasure to be a part of.
Yeah.
Ended a bit sour, but these things happen.
Yeah, it did. It kind of, they just, didn't they, like the landlord or something decided he wanted him out or something, I can't even remember it all. It sounds like it's a lot deeper than that. So if you don't want to go into it, don't worry.
Well, I don't, you never know what who's
Yeah, okay.
listening. But I mean, it's suffice to say, none of the original crew that had been involved in Black Market had anything to do with it.
Right, yeah.
And it was purely a new owner change of direction
Okay.
situation, and then a full-on shit show after that.
Okay, so what did it end up
So
being? It ended up being a barber's and a coffee shop, right? As like there weren't enough of them. But
yeah, sad
okay.
mate. But fucking really great days, and all the people that I met through there was amazing. I love them to bits, and I miss them.
Yeah, okay, so let's moving on. Moving if let's so and I'm trying to think when did because Near Far would have been the last thing you did before you left, right? That was 2015 roughly.
Yes.
So before that, one of my favorite albums, The Binary Collective. We started
Forgotten
with,
gem.
yeah, we started with Sinskin, didn't it? It came out on like Triple X or something.
Yeah.
Sinskin Part
Yeah.
1 and 2. So the Binary Collective was me, you, Cam, and Damon.
Yeah.
So we must have just been in the studio one time and just wrote a tune. I'm trying to think out what the next sort of progression to us writing an album, because I was going look again looking through some researching some stuff and just finding all the stuff from those days. They're kind of like the project, the folder that we put together.
Yeah.
It was sick. I still think it'd make a great movie. But yeah, Sinskin, which one? Sinskin 1 or 2? There was I liked. I'm trying to think which one I liked. They were both pretty sick, weren't they? Sinskin was 2011, was it? Isn't that not on the? Oh yeah, it was. So get Jesus Christ, you had a busy year, didn't you? 2011.
Yeah, so that was. So then we wrote this when I came over for the
This was in Rosie's
launch.
box.
Yeah, and I'd come over for the launch of Council Standard. Cam had already moved to London at that point.
Okay. Was that vocal from? Can you remember what that vocal was from?
Hear the harmonizer.
Yeah. Thank you. was always, another one I always liked. I think, wasn't Damien, you can read, the actress was really into this one, wasn't he? Into this release. I remember him liking it.
That's nice to hear.
So then, yeah, so there was a 4-year gap between this and the album. So were
the
we
binary collective one?
Yeah. So were we planning it that long?
I just think it. Well, because I'd. So we wrote that when I came over, but then I went back to Melbourne for a bit,
for quite a while,
because I had to. I can't remember why. Just life, and then. And then we didn't really start. I think maybe you guys had been in, you, Damon, and Cam had been in, doing a few bits and bobs before I got back. And then it wasn't really that often that we were all in the room.
No, I remember kind of like working with you, working separately.
Yeah,
I think there's, so there's like me, Cam. I remember me, Cam, and Damon a few times, but then I remember there was me and you on a few things.
Yeah, and then.
But we had like a collective Dropbox.
Yeah. And me, you, and Cam did. I've still got it. It was like just a long 30-minute, just fuck around on just bouncing from keyboard to keyboard, just
that sounds
doing
right.
Shit. And,
here they are, the original Binary Collective.
Yeah.
There we are. There's our controller.
Mm-hmm. that was good.
Yeah, it was. So I was looking at, I remember, we did a, I don't know if you remember, we did a, there was like a mood board that we had. Where we kind of like, it was like things that we wanted these things to inspire what we were doing. And I remember we were all just dropping like images and stuff into a folder. It was like, this is the world we want to soundtrack. I found the original text for it. Let me see if I can find it quickly. Which I always loved. Where are we? The Binary Collective. Binary. Here we go. A little about the movie. The movie is called The Binary Collective. It's based in a future where all information is stored in the cloud and cloud storage companies and the multinationals that influence government's policy and ultimately the people. The movie is set after the great cloud crash of 2323, caused by a solar flare which brought about a data war, aka Web War One. Check us out. Powerful governments, the wealthy and multinational corporations' data are safe due to them storing them in shielded sites and having prior knowledge of the flare. It's based in a time where all of society is forced to use cloud data companies to store their personal and financial information. Higher levels of security and storage are available for the wealthy. The poor are forced to use black market data storage. A person's online avatar has a credit rating. I think we were quite pretty prophetic with some of this stuff. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, that just sounds like you're describing last week, Dan.
Do you know what I mean? characters. A group of agents who are called upon to infiltrate and retrieve data from whoever they're told to. They have a unique skill set that makes them perfect for the task. They were formed by an unknown source, and each of us has their own reasons for being part of the collective. Blackmail, money, death wish, etc. The image below represents them, with the main avatar in the middle being their controller. We don't know who it is. Could be an autonomous computer system that feeds them intel. So that image that we always like, that's supposed to be who we are. It is like the B team, isn't it? Or the C or D team. And then it gets a bit all like, Binary Collective are hired by a Western data company to retrieve sensitive data from a business whose data is stored within a Chinese-based cloud service. The company in question is a hostess bar, which was purposely set up on a black market Chinese cloud service by a UK company to collect data on Chinese businessmen and their government ministers that use it. the hostess bar recorded everything that went on, and all data was stored on the black market cloud service. It transpires that the black market server is secretly owned by a much bigger Chinese multinational with ties to the ruling Chinese government. They set up black market servers with every intention of collecting data, knowing that criminals in the underworld would use it. Fuck me, it's getting...
This is deep,
man. It is getting deep, isn't it? Yeah. And then, like, had a hostess of beautiful women, some of which are cloud company plants, aka F nodes. I feel like that was Damon, F nodes. They're planted to create compromising situations with their clients. The information to be retrieved is for a UK government minister who frequents the bar and is being blackmailed by the Chinese government to push through legislation that can increase their power in Western markets, maybe a contract to store Western data. This legislation could possibly start Web War 2.
Whoa.
The Binary Collective are tasked with retrieving this data. You see, it's like, I like the fact that we had this kind of like whole scenario and idea, do you know what I mean, in our head. About what it was, what this music or what it was soundtracking. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I think that's how when we approached each track, you know, we had scenes in mind and shit like that. Mm. This is where I like where this bit goes. It's like a deeper story, the underlying arc or something. The Binary Collective discover dark data hidden in the code they retrieved, a new data drug called Ek. It's a drug that machines and computers are addicted to. The machines purposely seek it out and consume the dark data. It has the ability to control the addicted machine once infected. Originally created by a group of unknown coders, it was designed to control corporate computers and machines to bring about the end of their stranglehold of people's data. It is now known that it has an adverse effect on the human population through augmented warping. By changing the things we see and hear, the machines are able to change the things we think, say, and believe, warping social media, augmented devices, and thus brainwash. The designers were unaware of the mutation, and much like bird flu, it has now crossed over and begun to affect humans through their server-connected augmented devices. Government agents discovered this crossover and now want it for their own means to force their own political agendas on another country's population. The possibilities from this discovery are immense. The Binary Collective discovered Ek and its dangers and faced the dilemma of what to do.
Wow. Jesus,
man. Do you know what I mean?
You need to get your cousin on it.
I should actually. I have a word with Jamie. I should send him that. So write me a graphic novel.
Yeah, can we do a comic?
Do you know what I mean? I got some.
Well, that was one of the ideas, wasn't it? To have a comic.
Yeah. We even had like possible lines of dialogue and shit. Him, there's nothing you can say that will convince me. Her, is there anything I can do? that's Damon. Oh, that's got to be.
Oh, my God. Okay.
And then another one, they have an overdrive. No one said anything about an overdrive. and that explains the, whatchamacallit, the rise of the overdrive.
Rise. Is that one of
the rise of the overdrive? Sick, Jay. Because we knew, we even like I think we wrote out kind of these scene in terms of like the music and how it was gonna adapt to that scene. It was like we had this imagination of like this thing, this big dirty machine chasing them, and then there's a bit where there's a big jump. And you can hear that in the tune that we try to create that.
Yeah.
I
remember that. And then it went out into a little RP.
Yeah, the RP thing and shit.
Or like after the chase or after the thing had given up or something.
Yeah. See, there's a lot of big tunes on this album for me, like Cloud Creepy and I think Sick.
I love that one. Play that one. Yeah. I think that's my favorite.
Yeah.
Okay. Or one of them. I haven't heard the album for a while.
Thank you.
whole album. The whole album is sick.
That's a good one.
Yeah, I love it. There's what's the? Was it this one? There's one where we kind of like the percussion. I remember we recorded Cam tapping some keys in his pocket and shit. And shit like that.
So was it this one? I'm pretty sure this was you and Cam.
Yeah.
Because you can hear Cam's like the beginnings of his modular obsession.
True.
Clicks in it, the little sort of clicky hats. It sounds like.
Yeah. True.
Sounds like his little modular thing he'd started.
What was did it? Is it Host Night? Host Night is. I can't even remember. Hold on, let me get a quick look. This one. This one we this is around the time we were watching Beyond the Black Rainbow, wasn't it? Yeah. That had a big influence on this track. Ooh. Crazy film that is. Is this more? There's more of this Cam's modular in this as well, yeah.
Sounds like it. Sounds like that WAV player thing that we had.
Yeah, I nearly went full modular with that one because we used to like throw vocals into it and the way it used to spit them out in some weird random.
Yeah.
The way he did it was really cool. Creepy, isn't it? I want to see my father.
Yes, it's not a feel-good album.
No, but I think it had. I think that's like I say. What I like about it is it had a theme and it had a definite idea of what it wanted to be.
Yeah.
You know, it's obviously it's not been. It's. What should we say? Mythical soundtracks. I'm sure it's been done before, but it was just it was a nice project to kind of do and be a part of, and I think I personally think we pulled it off. And when the movie gets optioned, this is going to be the soundtrack for it.
just call me up, mate. Just let me know. I'll let you know where to send the checks.
Yeah. Right. So I found some of the other stuff from there, like the Binary Collective's, all their how they got to that artwork.
Graphic Surgery.
That's right. Yeah. Because they do some really cool shit.
Yeah, they do lots of installations and things like that, don't they?
Yeah. So it was like all this kind of like stuff, sort of this process got to where the album is. Do you know what I mean? I think we had sent them the album by this point, I believe. So they were able to hear it, weren't they?
Yeah.
I think that was important. Because that's what I really liked about Cam's album, Live For Never, because you remember, what was the guy's name? Where was it? Buna? He was your mate, wasn't he? From Japan.
Mm.
And he literally drew the album sleeve whilst listening to the...
To the album.
Listening to the album. So I think it's nice to kind of have that connection.
That album's amazing. But everything about it, like the artwork and the music... Yeah, you say like perfectly put together. That's for me. That's one of the most perfectly put together albums I've heard.
Yeah, it is pretty sick.
Yeah, it's amazing.
So that was 2015.
Yeah.
And then we're coming to the end of like when you've been in England for a while. You're working for me. You were posting out those records, all those records that people used to get in that era where. Hat were put together by Joe.
I'm sorry if any turned up broken. It wasn't my fault.
So then you were working on was that something that you had in your head as something you wanted to do, or was it kind of? Not so I won't say a collection of tracks, but you were obviously building music around that time. Mm. And it was Near Far something. I'll tell you one thing quickly. One regret I have is not doing a vinyl version of it.
I think that's. Yeah. It's probably my fault.
No, I don't think so.
I didn't exactly push for it.
Well, no, you know you wanted the cassette, but and that was I think you know it was cool, but I do kind of wish I had the album a vinyl of it, but maybe you never know.
See what happens. Maybe I'll revisit it. I think I've still got. I found an old hard drive from that era.
Oh yeah.
Got almost all the projects for that, almost all the projects that we started in the Honeysuckles and loads of shit. I've mined it for sounds, but it's so big that I've been too scared to look through it.
Send it to me, Keys.
Okay.
I'll get my mine on.
Yeah. All right. I'll dig it out. So I could potentially go back and maybe revisit some of those tunes.
You should. But also, we've been writing a lot of stuff as well, over this pretty much throughout the whole. When did we start writing? Throughout the whole COVID thing, I feel like we've kind of got things finished, didn't we? I really like them, but I'm eager to work on some more as well.
Me too.
We've pretty much written an album's worth of stuff. If not more,
probably
stuff that isn't finished. Do you know what, Will? Yeah. I am actually going to play that because that is a tune. That's for me. But yeah, we've written some stuff, but near far. Where was your head at with that one?
Where was my head at? That is the question, Darren. When did I start that? Well, you'd been pestering me for an album for a long time. just get it done. Everybody that's worked with Darren knows that saying. And the pestering is not the right word. You've been pushing me to do it, which I needed doing. You know, I needed at the time for sure. And I wrote most of it, I think, at the box.
Okay.
Apart from one, no, hang on, maybe one of them that I'd written over here, I'd started over here and then finished in the box. So it was kind of like, it wasn't like I'd had a load of things sat around that I'd cobbled together into an album. Pretty much all of it, apart from one, was written specifically for you and for that project.
Because I'm thinking around that time, because obviously, because I'd moved, I think I'd split up with my ex at that point, hadn't I? And I was in Farrow Road then. So then you were obviously coming down to the studio a lot, and I don't think I wasn't really using the studio that much.
I don't think,
so you,
I think
you,
that was...
You were there pretty much every day, obviously doing the day-to-day stuff for Exit, but then you you had the studio to kind of, to yourself pretty much.
For a long time.
Yeah.
Yeah, because Cam had moved back to New Zealand at that point.
Yeah.
And so it was just me and you and...
Charlie was in the other room. Was Craig's and that in there then?
Early on.
Oh, and is this true? Hold on. Is this true?
Yeah. Yeah, that's absolutely true. That sounds a lot like...
Oh no, Will's being a dick now.
I was notorious for that, like because there was that whole community that all worked in the same building, and everyone would listen to this, and I've been working on this, blah blah. I was the only one there, and like I'd see someone's face at the window, like Alex or Charlie or whatever, or Will, or and as soon as I saw him, I'd be like, spacebar. What are you doing? Play that shit.
Geez. But it clearly wasn't. And I think we're gonna play. I want to play. One of my favorites off there, which is hold on. See, this is that thing where I was talking about that, cause it's sort of feeling of nostalgia. Like the melody in this tune is so sick. Another one like that on here for me as well. Is it Doom Disco?
That's quite a... That's got no melody in it whatsoever.
Okay, then it's not that one.
maybe... What is it? Sort of synthy, melodic-y?
Yeah. Jewel, Barclay, Vertica, Oba? No.
F9. No, it's not that one. What was it?
That's F. No, it's not that one. No, it's not. No. That is pretty. But Doom Disco is bad though. There's a lot of good stuff on this album. So much so that I am actually going to give some codes away for it if anyone wants it to check it out. Hit me up in the Discord if anyone's... Piotr, have you... I don't know if you've got the link handy, have you?
Me.
No, not you, Piotr. he's good at this kind of stuff. Here we go. Let me find it. That's my server. Invite people. Edit. A copy. Okay. I'm just posting it in the.
That's right.
Did that work? I don't look like it did. Can you not post links on this chat? Oh, that's whack. All right. Hit me up. I'm trying to think how you can hit me up. Maybe I can post it over on Twitch. There you go. If anyone's on Twitch, that's the code. If anyone's watching on Facebook, that's the code. And if anyone is watching in YouTube, that's the code. Come over to Twitch, hit me up and tell me that you want... oh, look, see, it's... So you post in the other things and it comes up in here. Awful. Anyway, hit me up. Come over to the Discord and hit me up and then I'll send and tell me you want a code for Joe's album. I'm also going to, if anyone wants it as well, a code for the Binary Collective album as well. For a download, because I think everyone should hear them. So it's getting late now. Keys, I've got to get. See, you're already up. I've got to get up in 6 hours to get.
Jesus, mate.
Liam to school. Yeah. Well,
I'm inspired now, mate. I'm gonna
write
some music.
So what shall we? I'm trying to think. Let's end. I'm trying to think what we should end off. What shall we end on? Some. I've got unreleased stuff here. Where is new music? Should we play something we've done?
Sure.
What about the thing? There's which one? What do you reckon? It's the one with Damon.
Which one with Damon?
This one.
Oh yeah.
So this one, is it even going to play? There you go. Yeah, this one's featuring Damon. I do like that as well.
Yeah.
I think, yeah, we've got, like I said, how many things are we? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Eight that are mixed and playable, I think. Yeah. And then there's probably another 20 that aren't, but.
No doubt.
Anyway, look, Joe, I think, you know, it's about that time.
Okay.
Thank you for indulging me in this experiment.
Oh, it's a pleasure, mate. Thanks for thinking of me.
No, it's good. It's good to talk to you. Like I said, you are without doubt one of my favorite artists, and that's not something I'm going to say to everyone, and I think I've only ever said it to you.
That makes me feel all warm and fuzzy inside, Dave.
Good.
That's big praise coming from you. I'm honored.
Geez. So this is. Is that music still playing? Are you still hearing that?
Yeah.
Oh, sick. So I could have done that all along. I'm still learning, still working it all out. Yeah.
It's a good idea. I can't wait to see some more.
Yeah, so I'm going to be hitting some people up, chatting to them, talking shop. Because I feel, like I said, with the old studio thing, it's cool. And maybe I'll do it every now and then, but... I don't know. Sometimes it just, you know, when you got, it's that thing when people are watching you. It's just like, yeah. I'm almost not that confident. This, I feel it's a bit more, I can have a chat with people and with mates, do you know what I mean? It's a bit easier, shall we say. Vunique. Yes. That's what I'm calling it. That's an old, do you remember me wanting to do this years ago? Vunique. TV. We did some things on all the early stuff, all that era, that sleeve, you know, the left of center sleeve. We put up on Vunique. There was a YouTube channel called Vunique that we put all the demo, you know, the clips up on that. So I had this idea of expanding it then, but now seems as good a time as any to start doing it.
Yeah, I think it's great. We need to it'd be nice to do a They Live one with Cam and
at some point,
and so we can elaborate on that, because that's
definitely awesome. I want to get Cam on here, because everyone needs to see his lovely bearded face again, and then try and get him, vibe him up again, get him back involved.
Always involved.
True.
He'll always say, "Oh, I'm not doing music," and then he'll play like 100 things that he's done, and they're all amazing.
Yeah.
He's one of those people.
Yeah, he is. He's definitely. He kind of, because I sold him a load of stuff. I sold him my Octatrack. I think I sold him a pedal that actually got sent back. For some reason, didn't quite make it to Australia, New Zealand. Camcorder, do you know what I mean? Bring back camcorder. What was the other name he had as well? Busting Jeeber or something, wasn't it? Didn't he have a Busting Jeeber?
Yeah, he did a couple. Spike Mosley.
That's right.
Cam, he'll probably be pissed off that we've let the cat out of the bag. Sorry, Cam.
Sorry, Cam. Well, you should have been here then, innit? Really. All right, so
he'll be here. I think he wanted to be.
But. Yeah, I definitely want to do it again. I want to try and get Skeppy involved, and I wanted to speak to people within the crew, get an insight into who they are, what they do, and I hope this was enjoyable for everyone. And Joe, thanks again, bruv.
Darren, thank you so much. It was a pleasure.
Love you, Geez.
Love you too, mate.
All right, bye. Take it easy. See you later.
See ya. See ya.
All right. Thanks, everyone. I hope you enjoyed that. It's something I'm going to give it a go. Who's next? I don't know. Who's next? Who should we chat to? I think Skeppy would be good. And then there's obviously just people from the Exit catalogue. I'd like to speak to... I was thinking about like Synchro and Indigo, those guys as well. Mark System. Expect more of them. And thanks for tuning in, everyone. See ya.